Hey guys, you've probably seen many times videos about a mixture of sodium and potassium that forms a liquid alloy, but no one has ever made a video showing a mixture of the other two much more active alkali metals, rubidium and cesium. If sodium and potassium are usually stored under a layer of mineral oil, then the other two most active alkali metals, rubidium and cesium, are stored in glass ampules. In this video, I'll break these ampules and mix both of these elements to see what the rubidium-cesium alloy is like. I'll mix these two metals under a layer of mineral oil, but not fresh as you might think, but the one in which potassium was stored. This mineral oil is best suited for storing rubidium and cesium. It contains neither water nor oxygen, unlike fresh mineral oil. I'll mix them in 1-to-1 ratio. First, I'll pour cesium from the ampule, and then, after heating, I'll pour rubidium. Look at how the rubidium sits on the top of the cesium. Now I'll try to mix them with a glass rod. Despite both of these elements being solid metals at room temperature, gradually I managed to mix them so that they turn into a homogeneous mass. Look, the resulting liquid has a shiny metallic color. This is our very active rubidium-cesium alloy. Like the sodium-potassium alloy, the rubidium-cesium alloy is also liquid at room temperature and can be easily drawn into a syringe. This alloy is extremely active, and in the presence of even a small amount of oxygen, we can already see the formation of an oxide film. As soon as I try to squeeze it out of the syringe, it immediately becomes covered with oxide and turns into a solid mass. For this reason, the syringe gets clogged very often, and during the filming of this video, I had to change both needles and syringes many times. If we pour this alloy onto any surface, it will most likely catch fire, although as you saw earlier, it can also catch fire on the tip of the needle. Let's watch the combustion of this alloy in slow motion. Notice how the initially perfect liquid stream turns into a brittle wire after contact with air. I really like this purple flame, so I've added a few shots. Now I'll create an atmosphere of pure oxygen in this glass cylinder by pouring liquid oxygen into it. After which, as you guessed, I'll try to add a rubidium-cesium alloy there. Look how the steel needle of a syringe melted with such a reaction. Unfortunately, the glass cylinder also suffered. And now I'll add this alloy directly to liquid oxygen. Unlike the other drops, the first drop didn't explode upon contact with liquid oxygen because its surface was already significantly covered with oxides. Agree, it was quite unexpected to observe a destruction of the Petri dish from the contact of just one drop of this alloy. The reaction with water was much calmer. And here I decided to inject this alloy into a tomato. Do you remember how I carried out a reaction between a potassium-sodium alloy and liquid chlorine, and it didn't react at all? Now watch how the rubidium-cesium alloy behaves in the same situation. unlike the reaction with liquid oxygen. In this reaction, the petri dish remained intact. And now the reaction with bromine. As one would expect, upon contact with liquid bromine, this alloy instantly explodes. Even in slow motion, it's clear that the explosion occurs immediately the moment a drop of bromine touches the surface of the alloy. I know you love the iodine reactions, so I've added that too. This is a very interesting shot. You know, I usually make several takes of the same reaction and choose the best one for a final edit. Here, in this reaction, the liquid rubidium-cesium alloy due to oxidation in air hardened and formed something similar to a human figure. See for yourself if you find this similar to a human body, write in the comments. Now there will be a block of reactions with chalcogens. The first reaction with molten sulfur. And this is with sulfuric acid. The next chalcogen is selenium. To react with it, it also needs to be melted. There was sulfuric acid, and this is pure selenic acid. And finally, the reaction with molten tellurium. Well, I decided to finish this video by reacting with anhydrous hydrazine. If you look closely, you can observe a blue color of salvaged electrons, as happens when alkali metals are dissolved in liquid ammonia. Thanks for watching, guys, I'm sure you liked this video. Don't forget to like, leave comments and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. In the next video, I'll show you the most fusible alloy in the world. And of course, once again, special thanks to my patrons who support me financially, which makes it a little easier for me to create these chemical videos. See you in the next video!